Hi, everyone. It's an honor to be here. The diagnostic study of the dental arches has had an important evolution over time. Alongside the usual orthopantomography and the skull scan, some second-level techniques are now widely spread, such as the multi-layer CT with dedicated dental scan software and the combi-beam CT or CBCT examination. The radiographer has a key role in using this new equipment, both for the optimal capturing of volumes and during the image's reconstructions process. The healthcare professional has a strong responsibility in this context. He is the first to directly interact with the patient. He must know the diagnostic tool that he's using by optimizing the dose and by rebuilding a range of diagnostic images. Compared to the normal multislice-CT, the combi-beam techniques allows the pulsed emission of radiant beams in just one rotation of the detector tube, using an X-ray beam with conical morphology and a single detector, flat panel or balanced intensifier. The machine is also characterized by low weight, standard power, and lower cost. The radiant dose emitted is 5 to 20 times lower than that emitted with the conventional CT techniques, also for the shorter duration of the exposure. The examination of both jaw with combi-beam CT has a very small dosage, comparable to the one received after 2 7th orthopantomographies or after the exposure from 3 to 6 days to background radiation. However, the limited fields of view allowed the use of relatively small anatomical structures. Furthermore, the not totally comfortable position for the patient raised the risk of major problems for motion. In addition, the density values in CBCT seems to be little reliable because they are influenced by the position of the patient. So the condition does not allow the proper characterization of the soft tissues. The combi-beam CT can be used in the clinical practice for studying dental implants, dental anomalies, cysts, odontogenic and not odontogenic tumors, inflammation, for the examination of the temporomandibular joints and disease of the sinuses. Despite these constraints, a careful evaluation of the volumes acquired for the simple jaws, sinuses, or temporomandibular joints allows studying a range of collateral findings widely examinable with dedicated reconstructions. We retrospectively studied 30 patients who undergone combi-beam CT between June and September 2015 using standard capturing for the examination of the feet, of the temporomandibular joints, and of the paranasal sinuses. Apart from the standard reconstructions, some reconstructions of the cervical spine and the temporal bone were performed. The upper portion of the cervical spine has been examined in all patients who underwent the standard study of the dental arches, with a lower dosage than the multilayer CT and with a single dose. It is possible, in fact, to simultaneously study the dental and extradental structures. In addition, the cervical spine can be studied in physiological position. The temporal bone with middle and inner hair can be studied in all patients who have undergone the study of the temporomandibular joints and of the sinuses. For example, this is the results of a standard study of the temporal mandibular joints performed on a patient who suffered from pain when opening his mouth. After sagittal and coronal reconstructions of the temporomandibular joints, we have tried to reconstruct the temporal bone using the same temporomandibular system. These images, instead, are taken from the examination of the arches of a patient who underwent the combi-beam CT for an implant assessment. Following the standard reconstructions, we have reconstructed the cervical spine. These are temporomandibular joints reconstructions in a patient suffering from inferior anterior subluxation of the condyle and from anterior displacement of the disc, on which we have then reconstructed the temporal bone structures. In this case, instead, we have captured the dental arches of a patient who had to make an implant assessment, and we have rebuilt his cervical spine after soon. The aim of the work behind understanding and setting the limits is especially of assessing the possibility to range as much as possible in the area concerned by the study. Also in this case, the role of radiographer is extremely relevant. In fact, in a perspective where the raw data are subject to numerous reconstructions, the radiology technicians becomes the pivot of the CBCT examinations, since he's the only one able to put in full light everything is visible, being well aware of the invisible that is around. Among other things, it is important to interpret the principle of dose optimization not only as a commitment to develop study protocols by using the lowest possible dose, but also as an attempt to get the most information from the scanned images so that the dispensed dose is well used. Thanks for your attention.